Thank you, Rick. Molweni Maqaba. Rick, I strayed somewhat from the title breeze. You gave me.
I can see, yes.
I'm calling this that in us as Africans in this part of the continent, there's a part of us that's quite stubborn in recalling our pre-colonial moment, our identity.
I think you need the mic, Mazibuko. I don't think I can hear you on the other end.
No, it's fine. I can speak loud.
Okay.
There's a part of us that is given what happened with apartheid and colonialism, that seeks to recall, that seeks to repair. But then as it does that, it also then opens room for what is fairly problematic in the system of chiefly rule, which I refer to here as feudal. Then the second point that I reach beyond my mandate, Rick, is then to take the discussion a bit beyond my time zone that you allocated me in terms of the periods of history. I wanted to start with that. Before I go ahead, there's some voting that we have to do on several statements. You've seen this one outside already. Who agrees with Gov? This one is outside. Who agrees that Gov is basically saying apartheid changed how chiefs worked. There was give and take, there was consensus, there was, and so on. Who agrees with him? Those who agree with him, I want their hands up.
You want to line up behind the
camera? Okay. Are we confused what Gov is saying here? Huh? It's outside there as you walk in. So you're not reading it for the first time. And here it is again. He's writing on the Black Authorities Act of 1951. He says the Black Authorities Act of 1951 takes away give and take inner edge that we have in the customary system. It now imposes this big, powerful guy who's the chief. Do you agree with him?
Yes.
Okay. So all of you vote for him. Mandela says the same thing that he writes in that statement. So let's leave this one as the warm-up. Now, Mtikaka, the Tembu chief, people no longer obey the chief because there are no laws to compel them. The Transkei Authorities Act was against illegal gatherings, but now people do as they please. If you are not clear on Tikaka is saying, see what Olomisa then says. Let us not confuse each other and misinterpret that equality shall be applicable to each and everything. No woman can be the head of a family. The head of a family is always a man. That's the deputy minister of labor. Mnandia boom. Brian, how boom? Brian, how boom? Nolund? Zwe, how boom? My vote is not going well yet. The people of Port Elizabeth, Grahamstown, and East London, black and white, are governed by rights, democracy, and development. The people of Kaiskamahoek, Kofi Mvaba, and Lusikisiki, all black, are governed by custom, tradition, and welfare. Now, what Ashley Westaway is saying here is that rural people are not citizens. It's urban people who are citizens. Do you agree with him?
No.
Why do you disagree? We're all citizens. But why does Ashley write that then?
He's crazy.
He's crazy.
He's
Okay, it may be useful to debate this point, but I will leave it for now. I can't remember the year of the communal land tenure policy, but to confirm what Ashley is saying, it says the responsibilities of rural people are to pay taxes, to obey laws, to consume goods and services, and vote. Which way do we vote here? Nakuzihlawula irhafu, niyithobele imithetho, nithenge ezithengwayo, nivote. Come again?
That's incorrigible.
That's what is happening.
Yes.
Do you like it?
It's
is it acceptable? That's the question.
No, it's not normal.
Okay. I'm not debating these things, Rick. I'll leave them to you for a discussion. Nanguba Mupriska.
Yeah, but if you can remove the last part of vote, and leave others, I will agree.
Obey laws.
Right.
Even if it's unjust laws.
Yes, because if you don't want to do what the chiefs tell you to do, you are being evicted.
So there are consequences if you don't obey laws.
Yes.
Okay.
But the vote part, it is the democratic right of each and every person.
Okay.
That one I don't agree with.
Okay. You agree with Mama Priska here?
Yep.
Okay. Okay, my comrade. This is what Rick had asked me to do. To cover quickly what has been happening with the changes in the role of chiefs over time. I'm insisting to call them feudal structures. And then some reflection on popular struggles. But then the word he used was factors shaping this changing position and role. I changed it to say dynamics and logics. But now, Rick, I was not clear. You said the role of chiefs in the transition to democracy. That one can be read in two ways. What role they played as the country was changing, or the other meaning could be that they played a key role. So.
No,
that's why I put a question mark there.
Yeah, not the second.
Yeah. And then I thought, let me stray beyond my mandate by also putting some questions for us about what this discussion, the entire school for the week is raising, about what implications the things we're discussing have for rural struggles and movement building. I'm moving fast now, comrades. As I was saying, to cover the historical period of the role of chiefs, I want to start by going back to the late 19th century, the second half, the 1850s onwards. Basically, there was the Cape Colony, there was what was called the Transkei Territories, there was Natal and the Four Trekker Republics. All of them had different ways in which they were trying to think, now that we've taken the land, what do we do with these people who are still on the land? Do we allow them to follow their customs, their systems of self-rule, and so on? So these four countries, the Cape Colony, the Transkei Territories, Natal, and the Four Trekker Republics, followed different approaches. At some point, they would have recognition that these people live in their own way. They've got their own ways of doing things. But actually, no, that's against our way of thinking about what civilization is, or the way they do things may actually get them to be angry again and to want to take back the land. So they at different moments, I will not go through the story, but at different moments, they would do various things. But basically, what they were doing is explained. Ultimately, if you look at what they were doing throughout those years, is explained by a writer from Uganda called Mahmoud Mamdani, who says basically what they were doing was to define what customary law is, what a native is. And by defining that in a particular way, you then rule that person. We are able to rule. The identity of being a native is a political identity that serves particular political institutions, particular political interests. Samba song? But I'll continue with the story a bit more. Now, I choose the example of KwaZulu, where then Theophilus Shepstone, as the colonial governor, administrator, lays the foundation for what in 1891 becomes the Natal Code of Native Law. Now, the Natal Code of Native Law basically says, I, as Shepstone, understand these natives as follows, and I will write what I understand. And what I understand must not disturb the interests of the colonial government. Number song?
Yeah.
Listen to the powers they give to the Governor General of Natal. All the powers, authorities, functions, rights, immunities, and privileges, which according to the laws, customs, and usages of natives, are exercised and enjoyed by any supreme or paramount native chief, are now given to the Governor General. In other words, those powers that a king in the Zulu system would have are taken away from the king now. Now the king of all chiefs in KwaZulu was going to become the Governor General. Power to call upon chiefs to render military service, to supply armed men, to supply levies so as to suppress disorder and rebellion. Authority to exercise in these functions to punish disobedience. And then the Governor General was also the upper guardian. So ninanini onguye ojonge wakhathalela bonke abantu basinatives. Power to appoint and dismiss chiefs, power to change the boundaries and how the tribes are composed, and so on. Now this basically means that the chieftaincy system was changed. You can then go through various things that get done in different other provinces, those parts that become provinces later on, where you see a similar thing. In the case of the Eastern Cape, after the 1856 Nongqawuse cattle killing movement, George Grey does something similar and also introduces headmanship, which was not necessarily present in the way that he introduced it, because it was taking power away from the chiefs. In particular, it's not just the chiefs, but in terms of customary structures, what people were doing. And of course, what he also does is to introduce villagization. In other words, instead of people staying in family clusters across a vast area, people were then forced together. That changes how land is allocated, how land is thought about, how land is used. But basically, what you get from this is ultimately something else that people have said who are writing about these things, is that you had indirect rule that was composed of three legs. They were not going to govern the natives directly as the colonial government. You use the chiefs as some way of governing the natives. So you give some form of recognition to some native leader. You can call that native administration, but that leader is subordinate and is an agent of the colonial state. You give this leader also some power over some kind of court, but those courts are still subordinate to the main courts. You also give this chief some power to generate some money through treasuries that they were running. Poll tax and other taxes could get paid there. When the men go to the mines, they could make some contributions or other payments to these chiefs. Now, clearly, what happened there distorted things in various ways. I don't have time to go through this, but for example, in the inland groups in Natal, some of the people did not necessarily appoint the first son of the first wife to be the successor to the chief. the successor to the chief would be the son of the wife whom the nation had paid lobola for. But now the Natal Code changed that. So that you can see already how custom gets changed. Are we together?
Yes.
Okay. I won't go through the Glen Grey Act. That's a specific Eastern Cape thing. Time is charming me there. So now, the Natal Code of Native Law, the Glen Grey Act, mark the two most important pieces of law before we had the country called South Africa. Then 1910 comes about. 1910 then creates this one country out of those four areas I was mentioning earlier. Then in doing so, what 1910 does is to lay the foundation for bringing the different practices of those four areas into one native law. Of course, it doesn't become one native law in 1910, but there's now a foundation that can be followed. The first significant development after 1910 is this bill, the Native Administration Bill, as an administration bill, which did not get passed in the form it was originally proposed. But ultimately, it proposes for the first time that there must be separate black authorities. And then what it also establishes in a very detailed way are the native courts, the tribal courts, in quite a systematic way, but also the overall system of native administration. Now that's fine, I'll cover that in no time. Then that Native Administration Act continues for a while. There are other laws that get passed in 1937, the so-called Herzog Bills. What they do is to introduce betterment, which leads to forced removals. But then 1948 comes, the National Party gets elected into government. The National Party comes with even more vicious two laws. There are many others, but I just chose two. The Black Authorities Act. Now, the Black Authorities Act, is there a stick? Yes, there is a stick.
There's a big stick.
Yeah. The Black Authorities Act does a very interesting change. It's supposed to develop native local government through this change. At the basic level, it's your tribal authority. And then you would have a number of tribal authorities coming together to form a regional authority. But then you can take that further into a self-governing territory. At some point, the Ciskei, KwaZulu, Venda, and so on, were self-governing territories. These self-governing territories, if you follow this chain, were basically a conglomeration of regional authorities. Regional authorities themselves being a coming together of different tribal authorities. In other words, at the heart of the whole land system was the tribal authority. Are we together?
Yes.
So the homeland system was devised in that way through the Black Authorities Act. There already, the Black Authorities Act also gave space for some of the self-governing territories to have some ability to pass specific laws, like the Transkei did in 1965. I'll leave that there. There's more the Black Authorities Act covered. But then, what's also important is 1959, the promotion of the Bantu Self-Government Act. There, Verwoerd was as clear as anything. The white man wants to retain his domination over his part of the country, 87%, and is prepared to pay a certain price for it, namely by giving the Bantu full rights to develop in their own areas, 13%. But the foundation for this Bantu to develop in their own areas is that system. Remember song?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I'll leave that. I wanted to cover that ground first before I can talk about rural struggles. I didn't see Aninka's presentation. I may cover some similar ground. But there's been a whole range of things people did, not just political struggles. The first struggle after the Union of South Africa is when people realize that the Land Act of 1913 is coming. So people begin to buy land as consortiums and other things in the Northwest, in Mpumalanga, primarily in the Transvaal and smaller parts elsewhere, where they are trying to keep as much land as they can within their limited resources. So Dakar's Kraal comes about from that, some of the land of the Bafokeng that there's a struggle over today. Of course, some of it was bought in the 19th century. And then there's a whole range of return documents, submissions to retain, submissions to the parliament in Cape Town against the Land Act. And then other struggles that took place when there were people who were fighting were quite localized in the 1910s. The first moment that you get a national voice that speaks in a very clear way on the land question, of course, was the ANC. But the ANC was not as powerful as the ICU was. The ICU was the National and Commercial Union. So when workers who were joining this union came, they also brought the land issue to the union. And then they saw the ICU as ICU white men. That's how they were talking about it. That's how they were framing it. But it collapsed in the early 1930s. So it did not eventually take forward and bring changes. But it was like the first big national movement that was paying some attention. There were a whole range of struggles against black spot removals. Black spots being those areas that were outside homelands that still had black people owning land. Now clear these black spots in this white area. So there were struggles against that. In the Eastern Cape, there were massive battles from the 1940s onwards against the betterment laws that came into place. The Pondos wake up in 1960 in a big way, in fact from 1955, to rise against the Black Authorities Act. That revolt was quite significant. That's why he then wrote the book he wrote, because it was, okay. And then what he also does in that is to connect the Pondoland revolt with revolt in Limpopo against the same Black Authorities Act. So what the Pondoland revolt also underlines is the end of your particular wave of struggle, because then organizations get banned, 1960-1961, Sharpeville massacre, people leave the country, going into exile, leaders get arrested. So also in rural areas, there was a decline in struggle. In fact, at some point, there were about 113 chiefs who had been banished, moved from Mukhalakwena, taken all the way to the Eastern Cape as banished people, as banned people, a language they cannot speak, and disconnection with their community and so on. So there was just wide-range suppression. So, and also that meant that people felt that they didn't have leaders or people who could inspire them or could help them organize. But then that suppression and repression of the apartheid government is loosened somewhat in the 1980s with open rebellions against forced removals, against imposed chiefs. There's a specific Chisa movement in Tsala that basically challenges Matanzima in quite a significant way, to the point that actually Tsala was a no-go area for Matanzima. And of course, the uprisings are also against roles that tribal authorities were playing, particularly imposing fines, beating people up, or even exposing political activists. I won't go through Contralesa. Now, basically, out of these struggles, you get Contralesa born. Some wise chiefs decide to move and form something they call democratic. Then the other consequence of these struggles is the content of what is contained in the interim constitution of 1993. I see you're already negotiating. You're going back to the negotiations. So one of the things that get agreed to in the interim constitution is that basically there's a strong push from rural organizations. The UDF influences the ANC in particular ways in that regard. But ultimately, the interim constitution says, no, the homelands have to come to an end. And the governmental powers that chiefs had from all those laws we were mentioning have to be removed. There's also an act that gets passed alongside the interim constitution. It was called the Local Government Transition Act, to effect a transition in the local government structures. Now, insofar as the role of the chiefs was concerned, this interim constitution says only the customary functions, which are not governmental in nature, will be given to chiefs. That's quite an achievement. But Condoleezza obviously is not happy with that. And then ultimately in 1996, we get a new constitution. Now, this one is quite an interesting one, because up to now, most of us who have been looking at these laws and the constitution, we've said the constitution confirms what the interim constitution had said, no governmental powers to chiefs. But I'm quite confused by the wording here. Yeah, I think it's ambiguous. If you read it, the institution, the status, and the role are recognized. Of course, there's a key phrase there, according to customary law. Now, there's to be a big debate about the meaning of customary law. Now, Section 212 of the Constitution empowers Parliament to pass law. That law must provide a role for traditional leadership at a local level. Now, I think that's quite an ambiguous phrase. A role for traditional leadership as an institution. That word is full of meaning. At a local level, on matters affecting local communities. If you read the traditional and cohesive leadership bill, one of the functions of a traditional council is to administer the affairs of a traditional community. That's a wide phrasing, which is not inconsistent with this section. That's why I'm beginning to think that maybe we are quite wrong to think that the final constitution confirms what the interim constitution has said. Now, despite this caution or my skepticism I'm expressing now, there has been a particular way of interpreting the constitution, particularly by the Constitutional Court, which basically suggests that the Constitutional Court believes that traditionally does not have a governmental role. It's largely customary. When they did this, when they certified the constitution, because the constitution had to go to the Constitutional Court to be certified as being in line with the interim constitution in terms of the 34 principles. The Constitutional Court, in its judgment, when it certified the constitution, it said specifically the role of chiefs does not include the communal role they played before. And then it also says national legislation that caters for the role of traditional leaders may not include these governmental powers. That's the Constitutional Court. It continues to introduce a second element when it comes to living customary law. It keeps saying customary law is owned by the people who practice it. It will be changed by them. And of course, they also say it will be changed by courts. But they say customary law is not the version Shepstein and George Grey gave us. They keep saying that. And of course, the Black Authorities Act, in several judgments, they come back to this in a significant way. Now, given this background, what then do the post-1994 laws say? Many of you have come across these laws, the Framework Act, the provincial laws born out of the Framework Act, the Communal Land Rights Act, that's not law, and then the various versions of the Traditional Courts Bill, the Traditional Affairs Bill, and now the Traditional and Cohesive Leadership Bill. But basically, what the Framework Act does is to say those tribal authorities of the past shall continue. The boundaries that were imposed shall continue. Remember, the Governor General in Natal had power to change boundaries. Those changed boundaries that he changed shall continue. Samba song? The tribes shall continue, and then there'll be some 60%, 40% change of tribal authorities to traditional councils. 60% appointed by the chief, 40% you may vote for. And now in the Traditional and Cohesive Leadership Bill, the quorum for traditional council is 50 plus 1, which means 60% of the chief will always be the quorum. Anyway, that the Framework Act opens the door to what happens in the bill. And then, very significantly, if you look at the question of governmental powers, Section 20 of the Framework Act lists all its areas, agriculture, health,
legislation of health, legislation of marriages, management of natural resources,
as powers that can be given to traditional councils by government departments. These are two broad powers and so on and so on. Are they not constituting a form of government? Then the Framework Act has got provincial laws. In the case of the Limpopo Act, the Limpopo Act even specifically allows for levies. A chief can impose levies through the traditional council. So basically, the story you have here is summarized in this diagram. 1927, Native Administration Act, 1951, Black Authorities Act, they live on. In the Framework Act, of course, Clara is not a law now anymore. Possibly in the TCB if it comes back in the way it was, but definitely in the traditional and Khoisan leadership bill that we have to face now as public hearings are coming, most likely in April. Remember, the Black Authorities Act gave us, was part of the apartheid system, it gave us unaccountable governance powers, which were also present in the Native Administration Act. It also gave us tribal authorities. Now, in the Framework Act, those tribal authorities are traditional councils. The boundaries of the past shall be deemed to continue to exist, as the Framework Act says. You can go on and on to analyze this diagram. But all these features that are in the Framework Act live on in the traditional Khoisan leadership bill. Don't worry.
I'm not worried.
We are there. We are there. So in effect, the 1994 laws, chiefs have significant powers in law and practice. They change, these laws change the balance of power. They give not just governmental, but also powers over development, but also judicial powers. Inkosi iyabazi zikhosi thathu inye. The Trinity, isn't it, was your constitution of 1996? Says Parliament is not the cabinet. No. The cabinet is not the courts. Amazon? Eh? The courts are not the police. That system is called separation of powers. Ne? But now the chief could potentially have all his powers concentrated in him if the Framework Act Section 20 were to be implemented to the full. Or Section 20 of the National Question Leadership Bill, because it provides for a similar approach. And then, of course, we know how vast the areas are. These powers are not just going to affect a few people. They'll be in vast areas and exercised over a large number of people. Okay, I'm done with the laws. I'm left with three or four slides. Now, given what the new dispensation has given us, what has been happening then when it comes to rural struggles? We've seen in the previous slides how then the roles are always affirmed by the state in particular ways. Earlier on, when the colonial state wants the chiefs to play the role of indirect rule, but serving the colonial state. That continues with the apartheid state. We saw the laws that after 1994 got passed, which maintain what we had from the past. Now, of course, there's a discussion we must have here. What interest of the state is there in maintaining those roles and functions in particular ways? There was a very short period, a very short disruption by the 1993 constitution. But by 2003, when the Framework Act gets passed, that disruption was now pushed back. So then, given that pushback, what struggles have been taking place? We folded our hands in the 1990s. We went to sleep. We were demobilized. We thought we had freedom. That's the first thing that happened. As rural people, as other people were organizing. That's important to underline because it also meant we lowered our guard. it also meant we're not following things with a critical eye. Am I lying when I say so? But then NGOs remained. There were NGOs that were there that played particular roles to support rural struggles. But because we folded our arms, our struggles then got led by NGOs. They were not doing that in bad faith, but they were not movements. They were not the people. They were offices and a board and funds.
Yes.
So that shaped how things happened. And many of them focused on restitution, because many people had been forcibly removed in terms of recent memory. There was very little focus on the part of many of the NGOs on rural governance. But just before the 2005 Land Summit, we began to see a shift towards mass movements. And largely, these were regionalized, these were localized. We remember the local people, or the landless people's movement, the ART is coming into place. Inyanda is coming into place as part of this growing shift towards the return to organizations that are constituted by people on the ground, fighting over a range of issues, from mining all the way to who has access to state resources in these rural areas. But these struggles have not reached that kind of point that the Mpondoland Revolt gave us in the 60s. Or even the 1980s revolt gave us, leading towards the interim constitution. Now, I want to conclude by asking us some tough questions. You see, this history I've narrated very briefly. When I look at it in several ways, I think it tells us three things. Number one, now in the post-apartheid period, the interest of the state is to have a measure and a system of social control. This indirect rule that it wants is not the indirect rule of the past, where there was a colonial project. But this one we have is a new form of colonialism, basically to ensure that rural people have a measure of social control over them that does not enable them to push further. What that system of social control does is to retribalize us. There's no chief without a tribe. It also has very problematic gender implications. It affirms Ashley Westaway's notion of citizen and subject, the urban citizens and the rural people governed by custom and so on. And also, this system of social control means there'll be limited democracy in rural areas. That's the first thing which I think is key in the logic of what we are seeing. The second element of the logic is what I refer to as the creation of circuits of accumulation. Now, the chiefly system is an opportunity for Nyapilane to strike deals with capital, with capitalists and so on. You get the Bayede wine brand, you get other things that basically seek to use the position of chiefs and ethnic identity for the accumulation of money by a small number of people linked to chieftaincy. So what you are seeing here is a two-way relationship between finance and culture. Culture is commodified and the commodity becomes culture. Now this is quite significant, because it means that our things are going to be quite intense in rural areas. The struggle in Kolobeni is partly about that. You've got the film in your pack, The Show Break. The third logic that's present in what is happening is the entrenchment, the hard wiring in a significant way, of very problematic discourses and notions and ideas. They are conservative, they are reactionary. A tribal authority necessarily has to be connected to power, to culture and territory, land. A tribal authority necessarily has to have a tribe. And in a tribe, there are those who are seen as indigenous and those who are not. There are very problematic notions about the position of women. You heard Olomisa yourself from the goat you saw. Then some of these distortions are even becoming cultural. I'm told Nyala Pilane even has a chair that's created for him in this boardroom. No one else sits on it. That's now going to become a cultural position, a cultural view, and so on. In the case of Marikana, what we also saw was chiefs from Pondoland trying to influence the workers so that they do not fight in a particular way in their struggles. Even now in Kolobeni, you see the chiefs being put in this position where they have to appear to be siding with government and the Australian mining company. Those three key logics, comrades, I think, is my way of understanding what is happening with what has happened with the post-1994 laws, of course, building from the earlier history. Now, in opposition to these three logics, let me just repeat them quickly. Social control, so that you in rural areas cannot ever be a power, a voice in your own name and right. You cannot challenge things. You cannot accept your citizenship. Social control. Number two, a system of accumulation, primarily for chiefs and other rural elites. Number three, very problematic, reactionary, conservative ideas, discourses, and so on, about culture and so on. Now, if these are the three logics that shape what is happening, are there counter logics? Are there different logics that suggest something different? There are, but in my view, at times these are hidden. At times they are open. Notions of whether we can democratically govern ourselves in rural areas from below. People in Tsendane, in Nekhana, they say they have taken a decision not to be governed by any Xhosa king or chief. That's an example of democratic self-governance, but the law doesn't allow room for that at all. Now, there's living custom. The research that comrades may have seen that was done in Kaiskamahook, in Rabatabama, and in Msinga says you are seeing single, never married women getting land in their own name and right. That's living custom. Those decisions are not made by government. They are made by local people. That's an example of living custom, a counter logic. But this counter logic is constrained systematically because the stage of capitalism we're in, as Dave will speak later on, when it comes to alternatives, means that some things are always going to be confined, very small. But also, this stage of capitalism means there's massive unemployment. So there's a huge social crisis. People even do things that they would not dare to think to do under normal circumstances. They say, indlala inamanyala, isn't it? Now you're going to see very strange things. Some people are even going to find that actually there's benefit in obeying the chief, in obeying the laws that oppress them, because there's no other option. There's no employment. Of course, what also constrains this is that whatever people are trying is still largely in the geography apartheid gave us. We have not changed that much, 13% and 87%. If you drive along the N2 from the Fish River all the way to the border with Mozambique, you see how full the N2 is. The land has become fuller and fuller and fuller. That's the Ciskei, that's the Transkei, that's the former KwaZulu. That's the constraint of apartheid geography. That's become even worse. And of course, what also constrains us is that our social movements are very weak. The last slide, Viva. Now, if I'm tracing for you this history of the role, functions, and powers of traditional leaders from the colonial period to the apartheid period, to the post-1994 movement, and then making a short note on rural struggles of the 1994, and then trying to think through what the three elements of the logic of what government is doing are about, and then trying to say there's a counter logic, but that counter logic is weak. In the next few years, what does the future hold? There's no doubt chiefs will claim the powers they have in terms of the law, or in, even in bills, or even in terms of political statements that government leaders make. That will hollow out democracy. There'll be oppression. There'll be accumulation. Accumulation, okay? Lendo yenziwa ngonyaka laphilana. Umakinana phakuni enziweni uzayithenga isanti ancho iaccumulation ke leyo iyavakala. Now that will happen without a doubt. In response to that, what you're going to see is a very contradictory process where rural people have unity with the chiefs, but also they struggle against the chiefs. That's why I'm calling it unity and struggle. It will be a relationship of unity and struggle. Unity insofar you are bloody confined to these rural areas. You, of course, you can move elsewhere, but you've got a whole range of routes that will mean that you will stay there. So you have to always negotiate the space, obey, and so on and so on. That's an example. That's what I mean by the word unity. But at the same time, if these chiefs claim the powers in the way they do, you are going to see the burning of the houses of the chiefs as it happened in Escort. You're going to see a group calling itself the Bafokeng anti-repression campaign, that struggle. I mean, how can you have an Bafokeng anti-repression campaign in 2016 when we're supposed to have democracy? But also in this relationship of unity and struggle, you have elements of with working with the chiefs, trying to work beyond the chiefs, but also trying to work against the chiefs. That's why I'm using that phrase there, with, beyond, and against. We accept, but also, this is the difficult thing. The cultural appeal of tribal rule is seductive. Siyathanda ukhahlela. Siyathanda ukuba ubone inkosi zinhle. Siyamthanda udala indlebe. I was quite shocked and surprised to see 15,000 people at Zwelonke's coronation in May last year. The Xhosa king. It would not have happened in the early 1990s whatsoever. It culturally appeals. So it's seductive. But as this happens, there's going to be strife and low intensity warfare. It's happening where there's mining. People are violating things and so on. Now this raises several questions for people who are in this room. What do you do then? My particular solution suggests that we have to think about movement building, given the weak state of rural mobilization. But then what politics of movement building? Is it just going to be opposition to one law? Is it going to be a local organization only, focusing on restitution, and then restitution issue is resolved, we move on and go back and stay in the villages? Are we going to begin to think about unifying our struggles in particular ways? How are we going to do it? But importantly, the Marikana moment from 2012 onwards tells us there are political shifts taking place in this country. Those political shifts suggest that the compromise of 1994 is somewhat being disrupted from below. Now, can we think about organizing movements without thinking about the broader context of these shifts? This question of counter-hegemony is a big word. But is that thing I was talking about, a counter logic, alternatives? Are there other ways of thinking? Are there other ways of doing things? But basically, the period ahead, comrades, unfortunately, is going to be difficult and complex. Thank you. Thank you.